All right. So we're going to keep this going. I hope you stay tuned in. Thank you guys for staying. Man, I can't believe, again, it's coming to the end. But you got some insight from several landscape photographers. Now we're going to let Mr. Josh Cripps come up and talk to you about the work he does in much more detail. Joshua Cripps.
Thanks, Mike. Huge thanks to Nikon for having me. I mean, if you guys have looked at this schedule, it's just this who's who of amazing photographers. So I'm really honored to be here. Before I get started, can I see a show of hands? Who out there is a landscape photographer or who likes landscape photographers? How many people are just tired and needed a chair to sit in? No, I'm happy to see that a lot of you are all about landscape photography because that's what I'm all about. I like it. I love it. I do it for my job. And what that means is I basically have the greatest job in the entire world because what I get to do is go to these insanely beautiful places and witness these moments that are unrepeatable and incredible, and I get to take pictures of it all. And this is the photo that I just mentioned in the previous panel, this incredible moment in New Zealand. And within that big umbrella of landscape photography, the thing that really gets my engine revving is what I call wilderness landscape photography. And what I mean by that is I like to go places that are a little bit harder to get to, places that are just a little bit off the beaten path, where basically the only way to get there is under your own human power. And the reason for that, the reason that I love photographing landscapes in the wilderness is because the wilderness is a place that is responsible for most of the most beautiful moments that I've ever experienced as a human. It's the place that I go to think and to feel and to nurture the relationship that I have with planet Earth. And that relationship, it turns out, is incredibly important because if you want to create meaningful landscape photographs, you actually need four very specific things. And the first of those things is you need a subject that you care about. You can create nice photos out of pretty much anything, but if the more that you care about your subject, the more that your passion is going to shine through and the more that people are going to identify with your work. Now, the best subject, the best story in the world is completely meaningless unless you have a compelling composition that shows off the most important aspects of your subject. If you're photographing an enormous mountain and you want it to look enormous, but you put on a big, fat, wide-angle lens and it becomes tiny, your composition isn't telling the story that you want to tell. Of course, you need to have good camera technique, and I don't mean just putting your camera on a tripod and getting a good exposure. I mean, are you really thinking about, are your camera settings helping you tell the story that you want? Are you picking a white balance that brings out the colors that you want to emphasize? Is your choice of focal length helping you exaggerate or de-exaggerate certain elements within the landscape? And the final element that you need, and this is what I'm going to spend the rest of the day talking about, is light. And that's because light is so powerful as an element in our photographs that it fools us into thinking a bad photograph, like this one, is actually a good photo, which this one definitely, definitely is not. I mean, there's this dumb little tree sticking out down here. The horizon is crooked. There's not really a dominant subject or story. There's really nothing going on in this photo except for some nice, pretty sunrise light. That's how powerful light is. And in terms of what makes good light, that's something that you guys all have to decide for yourself. For me, it's the dramatic, the colorful, the unusual, the atmospheric. And the really cool thing about that kind of light is it's totally, totally predictable. It always appears on days like this, perfect bluebird clear days. Just kidding. I'm just trying to see if everybody's paying attention. That light occurs on days like this, when the weather is so topsy-turvy, you don't know whether it's coming or going. And the reason for that is because the potential for dramatic light goes up as the unpredictability and the unstableness of the weather increases. And I apologize for making you guys look at a graph on your day off, but this idea is really important because it drives almost everything I do as a photographer. This is the reason that I love chasing extreme weather, because it gives me the greatest potential for crazy light. Now, of course, it also gives me the greatest potential for getting pounded on by bad weather, but that's the risk that you take. And one of my favorite kinds of weather to chase are monsoon thunderstorms. And very specifically, I'm a backpacker. I live up here in Mammoth Lakes, California, which is about 6 hours from here in the heart of the Sierra Nevada. I love to backpack into the Sierra whenever I see the signs of monsoon thunderstorms on their way. And when I first started doing this, my mom thought that I was crazy. She'd say, well, why on earth do you want to go out there and sit in a tent by yourself eating a sad half of a salami sandwich? So, well, it's not because I necessarily love being by myself in crappy weather eating a sad half of a sandwich. It's because when you take the time and effort and energy to hike to these incredible places in this amazing, dramatic, moody weather, well, as the storms start to break up and you come out of your tent, well, you get to see sights like this. And if you throw a 10-stop ND filter on the front of your camera and you channel a little bit of your inner Ansel Adams, you get to take pictures that look like this. And that's really what drives me. That's what makes me go as a photographer. And I want to tell you guys a story about a backpacking trip I did this past summer to a place called Kings Canyon National Park. Has anybody been to Kings or heard of Kings? Okay, cool. A couple of you guys. It's really, really, it's my new favorite park. It's insanely beautiful. It's part of the second largest roadless area in the contiguous United States. This is a very wild and dramatic spot. Now, this particular place is called the Ray Lakes Basin. As you can see, it's very beautiful, but it's also one of the most popular camping sites on maybe the most popular hiking trail in the U.S., the John Muir Trail. So when I was planning my trip into Kings, I decided not to go here. I decided to go to a very remote backcountry basin called the Gardner Basin. Now, the Gardner Basin, to get there, you have to hike a minimum of 2 days, and you have to go over 3 12,000-foot passes to get there. Now, me being the very, very intelligent person that I am, I thought, I'm going to save myself some drama and some trouble by picking the most direct and shortest route to get there, which meant I was going over this bit of rock called Dragon Pass. And this is an off-trail, it's a cross-country pass, which means you have to pick your own route to get there. And it was basically raining the entire afternoon as I was coming up this. Toward the top, it was all technical climbing, which, of course, I'm wearing a 40-pound backpack, pulling me backwards over. And when I got to the top, I picked this gully that I thought was the route down. It basically turned out to be a 45-degree slope full of loose rock that poured over a 70-foot death fall. So after I very slowly and carefully inched my way back up that gully, I went around the corner and I startled some bighorn mountain sheep, and I was able to follow their trails to another gully that I followed about 1,000 feet down to a lake where I camped for the night. And believe me, I was happy when that day was over. Now, the next day started off on a completely different note. Beautiful, blue, sunny day. And as you can see, I chose my shirt to match the sky because, as Dixie Dixon or Jerry Gionis will tell you, fashion is everything, especially when you're in the backcountry. And as I hiked along that morning, I got to see some pretty cool stuff, like flowers and lakes and mountains and reflections and trees, which was all very nice. But the thing that got me really excited that morning were those big puffy clouds up there on the right-hand side, because that's the direction that I was hiking. In fact, I was going up over a pass. Does this thing work? Well, I was going up over a pass somewhere over here. And when I got down to the other side of that, I saw two things. Looking to the north, I saw this very idyllic and welcoming view of these wonderful meadows and lakes and blue sky, and it just looked so lovely, like a great place to take a nap. And looking to the south, I saw something completely different, which was stark rock and dark clouds. And I had to make a choice. Which way do I want to go to spend my afternoon? Now, there are two parts to my brain, right? I have a very rational side that's going, well, why don't you go down and take a nap in those sunny meadows? But then I have the photographer part of my brain that says, hey, your entire goal for this trip is to go photograph the Gardner Basin, which is up over the darkest, where those darkest clouds are, under monsoon thunderstorm conditions. Now, you have no guarantee that those thunderstorms are going to be here tomorrow, so the only choice you have is to go right now, today. So, you know, against my more comfortable judgment, I strapped on my pack and I walked up towards those darkest clouds. And when I got to the top, I have to admit, I was a little disappointed by what I saw. I'd put so much effort into getting to this place, this fabled Gardner Basin, that I thought I was going to see this Shangri-La of meadows and wildflowers and happy little chipmunks scurrying around, you know, and cuddly bears with pina coladas. And what I saw instead was this. Just this lunar landscape full of this garbage talus. All of these enormous boulders of granite, anywhere from the size of a basketball to a refrigerator to a Volkswagen bus. And I went, are you freaking kidding me? I just put all this effort in to look at this? I don't even see a flat spot anywhere to pitch a tent down there. So I'm starting to regret my decision to hike up there, especially because when I look to the north, this is the view that I had. And these clouds are called mammatus clouds, and they're very uncommon in the Sierra Nevada. You tend to see them a lot more often in the Great Plains states when a tornado is about to form. And what they mean when you're standing on a ridge line, when you're the highest point on a ridge, is you're about to get struck by lightning. So I had to make a choice. Do I go back down into the basin to the right, where I just came from, where there are trees and meadows and beautiful streams and waterfalls and some blue sky, or do I go down into this garbage basin? And again, that little voice popped up in my head and said, hey, you came here to photograph this basin under these dramatic conditions. You're going to hate yourself if you don't go through with it. So sure enough, I said, at least I'll walk in as far as the far side of this lake here and see what it's like. Now, travel across this, as you might imagine, is pretty awful. It's only a mile. It's a mile from here to the edge of the basin. It took me 90 minutes to get all the way across it because you have to walk very delicately on this stuff. And even the huge boulders, the 10,000-pound boulders, can shift under your weight, which is very, very unsettling. But as I got to the far end of the basin, something kind of amazing started to happen, which was the clouds started to break up. The storm started to lift to the west. And this made me happy for a couple of reasons. One, it was nice to not be hiking in the rain and the hail anymore. And two, when I turned around and I looked behind me to the place that I just was, all I saw was this wall of rain moving in. And where I was standing making that pontificating face is basically right here. So I was happy not to be up there. This photo doesn't show up, but there was lightning and thunder going off. And so as I kept going towards the western edge of the basin, the clouds kept lifting, and the sun itself started to come out. And now this made me really, really excited, because as the sun came out, it started to penetrate this basin and light up this incredible granite features and even the rain itself that was falling from the sky. And who knows what happens when you take sun and you shine it on rain? You get, of course, rainbows. And when you're really lucky, you get incredibly intense, like vivid rainbows. And when you're even more lucky, you get double rainbows. And when you're quadruply lucky, you get something weird. And the longer I photograph this rainbow, the weirder it looked. Let me zoom in a little bit. Can anybody see there's a band of green underneath the rainbow? So I'm going, okay, because a rainbow is red, orange, yellow, green, blue, indigo, violet. Violet is the end of the spectrum. Why on earth can I see a band of green underneath the violet? So maybe I'm crying from joy or something and my eyes are all screwed up. I don't know, but I can fix this. So I got out my 70-200 lens and I zoomed in on the most intense part of the rainbow, and I saw something that I had never seen in my entire life, which was the colors of the rainbow replicated over and over and over again until they faded out into obscurity. And I looked this up later. It turns out it's something called supernumerary bands. And it only occurs when sunlight is refracted through a rainbow, through water droplets of a very, very specific size. And for me, this was the most magical thing, because as a landscape photographer, I spend a lot of time outside. I have photographed more than my fair share of rainbows. I thought I kind of knew what rainbows were all about. And then Mother Nature comes along and says, you know what, I still got a few tricks up my sleeve. So as the sun tends to do, it kept getting lower in the sky, and consequently, the rainbow kept getting bigger and more impressive. And then a weird thing happened, which was I started getting bored photographing this. which is not something that landscape photographers typically say when it comes to rainbows. But in this particular case, the rainbow was there for over 45 minutes. So as I photographed telephoto, wide angle, mid-range, every single composition I could think of, I went, maybe it's time to go off and explore a little bit more of this basin. So I put all my camping stuff down. I found this wonderful little campsite. And I walked around and came across this nice little tarn with these beautiful stepping stones in it. And as the clouds continued to break up in the sky, the sunlight was coming in these beautiful spots. And it would light up just the tip of the mountains. This is Mount Cotter. And I thought, well, okay, that's pretty cool. That's pretty nice. But let's go see what else there is. So I kept walking around, and the clouds are breaking up more and more. The sunlight is coming in warmer and warmer, and I found this amazingly perfect mirror-smooth reflecting pool that this entire cirque is now getting hit by the late afternoon sunlight. And this was really cool because this is about an 11,000-foot basin surrounded by 13,000-foot mountains. And so I had views in every direction. Now, this view was looking to the east, and when I turned 90 degrees and I looked to the south, I got to see genuinely one of the most beautiful things I've ever seen in my life, which was Gardner Peak, Mount Gardner, for which the basin is named, reflected in this infinity pool with the remnants of these monsoon thunderclouds breaking up behind it. And, well, to be honest, the most beautiful thing about the evening was there were no mosquitoes there, which is generally a plague in the High Sierra in July. And as the sun went below the horizon, the colors in the sky just kept getting more fiery and more intense and more beautiful. And I got to experience this incredibly magical day in the backcountry, all because I said, hey, that weather looks awful. Let me walk into it. And then something incredible happened on the other side. And the really cool thing about this trip was this happened every single day for 5 days. I would wake up with perfectly clear bluebird skies. The clouds would start to build around mid-morning. By the afternoon, I've got my hood up and I'm hiking through rain and hail and thunder and lightning, which is very intense when you're above the tree line. It's a little bit freaky. And then the clouds would clear and some amazing light show would happen around sunset. And on the last day of the trip, the second to last day, I was heading towards a place called the Kearsarge Basin. And as I was wandering my way up through the forest for an hour or so, I came across this rocky promontory that gave me this amazing view into the Kings Canyon backcountry. And this is one enormous canyon that sits below Deerhorn Mountain. And from this promontory, I could actually see five of these enormous canyons. And the view was so grandiose that I thought, I'm going to stay here and see what happens at sunset. Now, you can see how dark and gloomy the weather was. So I had 4 hours to kill, basically trying not to get hypothermic because I was soaked to the skin, put all my stuff under a little overhang, and I'm just moving around and jumping and dancing and taking selfies because the best way to stay warm is in the glow of your own loveliness, right? So as sunset is getting closer and closer and closer, I was starting to get a little bit discouraged, because the rain was not letting up. It was just pouring. Every time I thought it was clearing, another wall of rain would come in, and I'd get soaked again. So I was about to just pack my stuff up and shuffle off down into the trees and find a campsite when, miracle of miracles, a little tiny break appeared out in the horizon. And not only could I see the mammatus clouds again forming up over these beautiful mountains, but I could see blue sky out in the distance. And my photographer Spidey sense started tingling, and it said, you know what I think is going to happen is the sun, as it sets, is going to fall into that crack of blue sky, and it's going to shine up and light up the undersides of these clouds, and something amazing is going to happen. And sure enough, about 15 minutes later, the sun went into that crack, and it shined on the bottom of the clouds, and something amazing happened. And this was one of the most intense, most colorful displays that I have ever seen in the backcountry, lighting up all of these enormous canyons. You know, these mountains, it's hard to get a sense of scale, but the base over here, this is about 9,000 feet, and it's a 3,000-foot wall going up there. So these are enormous mountains, and I get to sit there and witness it and photograph it, which is pretty much the coolest thing ever. So for this reason, this is why I love chasing that extreme and terrible weather. And whenever I'm planning a trip, I'm trying to figure out when is the most unstable, when is the worst weather going to be. And honestly, I could sit here for about the next 3 hours and I could tell you guys stories of storms that I have chased through the Sierra Nevada because I really love to do this. And it has led to some of the most breathtaking and incredible moments of my life. But for the last few minutes here, I think what I'm going to do is shift gears a little bit and tell you about the time that I got to photograph a different set of mountain ranges in South America called the Cordillera Huayhuash in Peru. And this is called the Himalaya of the Andes. These are 21, 22,000 foot peaks here. So as I was doing all of the research for this trip, I wanted to figure out when the best time to go is, which is to say when the weather is going to be the worst. And I decided late August, early September is perfect. That's when the dry season changes to the wet season, and you have all of this unstable air coming in off of the Pacific, creating these huge storms that pound into the Andes. So I showed up in this little town called Huaraz, and I started going around to all the outfitters in the town, asking them if I could hire a donkey and a guide to help take me around these mountains, because I wanted to go take pictures. And they were like, you want to go take pictures now? Don't you know the weather is going to be terrible? So, well, yeah, you know, that's kind of what I want. And they were like, all right, dude, if you want to pay us, we will happily take your money and take you up into the mountains. But don't say that we didn't warn you, right? And because I didn't know this area at all, I said, well, let's do a complete circumnavigation of the range and let's pick a different campsite each night. So this was a 10-day, 100-mile walk around these mountains, and we picked a different campsite every single day. And basically what that meant was we were walking, you know, 10 miles a day, 14,000 to 16,000 feet in the Andes, no matter what the weather conditions were. And of course, the guides were right. We saw a ton of terrible, terrible weather. In fact, it rained on us nonstop pretty much every single day. And the only times that it wasn't raining was when it was snowing. And well, the rain and the snow weren't even the worst part. Frankly, the wind was the worst. It would come howling up over these passes and create this sideways frozen rain that when it hit you in the face made it feel like your skin was on fire. So I'm not going to lie, at times it was kind of miserable, which raises the question, why voluntarily subject yourself to misery in the mountains at 16,000 feet of elevation? And, well, the answer for me is actually really simple. It's because when you're going out and photographing in conditions like this, you can see the hailstones in the grass here, and you can see where the hailstones are pounding on the stream here. Sometimes, as the sun goes down behind these mountains, it'll light up the clouds, and you get to see something that looks like this. I mean, look at the light bouncing around this amazing Andean cathedral. Incidentally, I took this on my 33rd birthday. It was one of the best birthdays I'd ever had. And a lot of times, the thunderstorms clear out overnight, and you get to wake up to views like this outside of your tent flap. That's why I do it. And I do it because there are days when you hike through fog so thick that you can't even see the mountains, but you get to end the day at a lake that looks like this, that looks out at 20,000 plus foot mountains. And as the sun goes down, they light up with golds and purples, and everything is pretty awesome. And I do it because there are days like this when there's this thick blanket of clouds over the mountains and you think, there's no way anything is going to happen this afternoon. And all of a sudden, a little crack will appear in the clouds and a laser beam of light will come in and it'll transform the scene so dramatically that you never could have imagined what it would look like. And I do it because there are days when you're stuck in the tent for 3 hours because it's raining so hard, but eventually you get so stir crazy you get out to explore anyway. So you start wandering around and you find this really cool waterfall. So you walk up next to it and you set up a really a vertical composition to get the waterfall and the mountains and the clouds. And then you look out to the west, and you see a break in the sky, and you think maybe, just maybe, when the sun goes down, it's going to shine through one of those breaks, and it's going to light this whole scene up. Well, every now and again, that's actually what happens. And you get to stand there. You get to witness it. These moments get burned into your brain, and they make it all worthwhile, all the pain, the suffering, the misery, to stand there, to photograph this, to share it with other people. So that is why I love chasing extreme weather. Thank you guys a ton for your attention. I really appreciate it. You can follow more of my work online. Join me on social media. And again, a huge thanks to Nikon for having me. Thanks to everybody out there. Thanks to you guys. You've been awesome.